And so we look at that, and then as I was thinking about that, I really just felt like God was saying, remember Luke chapter 16, the story about the young man who had looked at his father and said, Dad, I want my inheritance today. The Lord, the dad, no matter what's going on in your life, and I don't care about you, I want to do what I want to do. And because of that selfish attitude, this man went out and spent all of his money on wild living. And I guarantee you, that you go ahead and read the story, but I guarantee you, the truth of that story becomes very evident in the fact that one day he woke up and his life was broken, and that became a marker in his life. And so tonight we're going to kind of talk about markers. Tonight we're going to talk about brokenness. Tonight's talk is called Getting Past Your Past, which I think is an incredibly difficult thing to do. Because we all have areas in our life that seem like they're pretty significant, right? Those areas that you want to get over, but you never quite get over. And when you step back and you look at them, you go, okay, well, maybe that area is not as significant as it should be, like losing weight. And once you hit a certain age, there becomes this need to like be in better shape than you really are because you remember what kind of shape you used to be in. And there's this desire to have that again. And so every year you go, okay, I'm going to be in better shape. And really, not that valuable, not that important. I mean, very valuable, but not something that maybe you will is so important to you that you're going to change your lifestyle over it. Or maybe one of those areas is that you know you should wake up and do your devotions every day, and you don't, right? Have you guys had that struggle? Have you felt that guilt come on you because you're a Christian, you've given your life to Christ? And so there should be this place where every day you should wake up and do your devotions, but you don't, and you feel guilty about it, but not guilty enough to do anything about it. You got those areas in your life, you got those markers in your life, you got those areas where you know you should watch your language or you should be paying attention to what you're thinking about because your thought life is probably not as honorable towards God as it should be, or what you talk about. And although they seem to never go away, or we never seem to get those areas in the place that we want them, we know that those are not definitely the issues that we deal with when we feel broken. That if we were really honest, there's things that happen in our life that happened to us that causes absolutely way more pain. That when we think about being broken, when we think about getting past our past, there's people in this room tonight that it would be abuse. It might be physical abuse, it might be emotional abuse, it might be spiritual abuse or sexual abuse. And when you hit on that nerve, it's one that you try not to let show. But when that topic of conversation comes up, there is this rise inside you. It's a spike. That when you talk about getting past your past, you're going along. And when that button gets pushed, it goes from life being a 2 in pain to all of a sudden this big 10 that spikes inside you. And it's like, okay, don't show it. But there it is. And all you have to do is be in a conversation where that comes up and it's like, there it is again. Or how about people that have done something that they so regret, and they so regret it that anytime they watch it on the news or anytime they're in a conversation with it, that the guilt comes back really, really strong. And then I know that everybody has those areas of regret, but there are certain people that when you talk about regrets, like, I mean, there's a lot of people that when you talk about regrets, you go, oh, yeah, there's a lot of things that I did that I regret. But there are certain things in certain people's lives that when you talk about those areas of regret, that for them is a spike. It's a 10. It's a oh my God, I hope nobody finds out about that. It's a I know that God has made my past right, but I've never been able to get past my past. I know that God has made my past right, but every time I think about that, it is absolutely crushing and disturbing. Or maybe there's people that have the issue because of their past and the things that happened to them in their past, the anger issue is their button. And it is just like you watch things. And I can tell you that early on in my 20s, I had this anger issue that somebody would just push the right button and I would just absolutely lose it. Have you ever had that happen? Have you ever been beating on your steering wheel because the lady at Taco Bell screwed up your order? If that ever happens to you, I got to tell you, you probably have an issue. And the only reason I know that to be true is because I had that happen to me. Just in my 20s, like, if you'd screw up my order at McDonald's, I mean, like, they make $5.65 an hour, you know what I'm saying? Like, they probably screw up your order on purpose. Because it's like, okay, my job is painful, so your life should be painful, so I know you ordered a double cheeseburger, but here's a milkshake, you know? And so you look at these things, and there's things that you watch in people's lives, and all of a sudden, you wonder, why is getting past your past so hard? Have you ever thought about that? What's the issue on that? Why should that be the issue? Why is getting past your past so hard? Why is it the fact that God can forgive it, but you and I don't have the ability to forgive ourselves? Why is it that events that happen in our past are in our past, but they remain in our souls? Have you ever thought about that? I mean, like whatever happened was an event in time, right? You got that thing in your mind, the one that you wish you could get past? And that was an event in time, but that event in time took something from my soul. That event in time took something from my heart. It took something from my relationship with God. It took something from my relationships, maybe with my parents, or maybe with my brothers or my sisters, or maybe with myself. And then you have to ask the question, if it's an event that happens in time, then why is it so hard to forgive myself for the very thing that God is able to forgive me for? And so Paul is addressing the church in Colossians. And he kind of addresses this. And if you have your Bibles, you can flip over to Colossians chapter 3. I'm actually going to read the whole passage in Colossians chapter 3. Actually, I'm going to read down to verse 17. And Paul says this in Colossians 17, "Since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven." We're going to pause right there, okay? "Since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven." Let's bow our heads and pray, because we are about to set our sights on the realities of heaven. Father God, that we come before you. That God, that tonight we're going to talk about our past, but only in terms to concentrate on you and to concentrate on the realities of heaven. And the reality is that, God, that there's so much that happens in this life that we don't have the ability to get over, and that is why we need you. That we have stuff that is so deeply wounded within our being that, Lord, that we need to be new creatures in you. And only you can do that for us and to us. And so, God, we're going to come before you, and that this is probably going to be a quiet service. But that does not mean that you are not working loudly in our lives. And so, Father, we just ask that your Spirit would be here. We want you to know that we love you. And there is nothing more important than our relationship to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I'm going to encourage you that during this service, that if there's an issue in your life, that you would set your sights on the realities of heaven. Where Christ sits in the place of honor, God's right hand. He says, "Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden in Christ, God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in all his glory. So put to death the sinful earthly things lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Don't be greedy, for a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. Because of these sins, the anger of God is coming. You used to do these things when your life was still part of this world, but now is the time to get rid of anger, rage, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language." If you struggle with any of those things, I'm going to reiterate that. Now is the time to get rid of rage, anger, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language. And don't lie to each other, for you have stripped off your old sinful nature and all of its wicked deeds. Put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and becoming like Him. In this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or a Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric or uncivilized, slave or free. Christ is all that matters, and he lives in all of us. I'm going to pause for just a second, because I think that when I went through that portion of Scripture, that there were people in this room, they went, ah, I want that, but I don't know if I can have that. I know that that's what God wants for me. I know that that's what Paul is writing the church, and I know that Paul is saying that these are the things you struggle with and that you need to let these things go. But you don't understand, Paul Watson. I've struggled with these struggles for most of my life, and I so want to get past them, but I can't. And the reason why I can't is because they're too deep, and I don't know if God has the ability to take them. And here's what I'm going to challenge you to. I'm going to challenge you tonight that you would come to the place where you understand that it is not just God's will for you, but it's God's ability and desire to be able to take those things from you. And so then he says in verse 12, he says, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tenderhearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. You must make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you. And that's going to be an important scripture. You might want to underline that. The Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds all of us together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your heart. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. Let the message about Christ and all its richness fill your lives. Teach and counsel each other with all the wisdom he gives. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. You see, here's what I believe. I believe that one of the very reasons that you and I have a problem with not dealing with our past is this. Is that we have a problem with what we think about. And what you think about determines where you go. You see, how many of you have experienced this? That you have somebody who wronged you, and in your head you replay that over and over and over. Have you ever done that? Oh, come on. I'm the only one. You guys are way chicken. Come on. All of us do it. Then what happens is somebody wrongs you, they hurt you, and you didn't react with the way that you wanted to react, and the way that you wanted to react would not be God-honoring at all. Right? You come up with that line, and you think, if I would have only said this. Oh, man, I got the perfect line if I would have only done that. And what we do is we replay that, and we think on it, and we think on it, and we think on it. And what we're thinking on is this, is if I could only get even, then I would be okay. And that is a lie from Satan. You see, what you think about determines where you go. And so he says, Paul says to the Colossian church, he says, here's what you want to do, guys. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. Think about what God did for you. You see, if you want to get past your past, then don't concentrate what's been done to you. Think about what's been done for you. Think about the realities of heaven. Think about that if it wasn't for God, you and I would be eternally lost. And that it was his grace and his kindness that led us to repentance. The reason we can't let things go from our past is we spend our days thinking about them right now in the present. We think about how badly we were treated by our parents and our coworkers and the people we went to school with or the person we dated. And then there's a scripture, and it's in Proverbs 23:7. It just says this. It says, for as a man thinketh, so is he. For as a man thinketh, so is he. For as a man thinketh, so he becomes. For as a man or a woman or for as a person begins to think in their heart, that's what they become. You ever watch somebody who was all happy-go-lucky and something happened to them? A girl that was all happy-go-lucky and something happens to her and she becomes bitter? Why? Because she thinks about it. You ever watch a guy who he was a pretty nice guy and things happened to him and all of a sudden you come across him a couple years later and now he's this angry man? Have you ever watched that happen? Why is he angry? Because he never let it go. That's all he thinks about. That's what he thinks about. And Paul says, think about the things of heaven. Think about the goodness of God. Think about the fact that God is the one who brings healing to your life, and it's his love for you that brings healing. Philippians 4:8 says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is holy, whatever is lovely and admirable. And if there's anything excellent or praiseworthy, those are the things you think about. If you want to bring change to your life, then think on God. Think on Christ. Think about the things that are worthy of praise. If you want to get past your past, here it is in black and white. If you want to get past your past, stop reliving it. If you want to get past your past, stop reliving it in your head. That come to the place where you say, you know what, God? You forgave me for that. Or God, I have forgiven that and I've let that go. The reason people won't get past their past is because they won't let it go. They relive it every day. You see, here's the second thing that I want you to write down. What Christ sets you free from, don't return to. Really practical, okay? Have you ever prayed a prayer for God to release you from something? How many of you have ever held anger against somebody? You've been angry against them, and you've said, you know what, God, I need you to help me forgive this person. And then months later, you're still angry at them. Come on, honestly, come on, that's true, right? And why? Because we keep returning to it. What Christ sets you free from, don't return to. Guys, when Christ sets you free from pornography, don't get back involved in it. It's not that God's power is not capable of setting you free from it. It's that your will is capable of returning to it. Right? That when God sets you free from something, when God forgives you, when God gives you grace in an area that you ask for forgiveness for, and I believe that when you say, Lord God, I need forgiveness on this area, and I believe that God grants forgiveness, I believe that He's also granted freedom. That in that, there are tendencies to struggle with sin. Because man is full of tendencies. But tendencies are not sin. Temptation is not sin. What sin is when you return to it. And so He says 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times in Colossians 3, 5 through 9, He basically says, when Christ sets you free from something, don't return to it. He says, put to death the sinful earthly things lurking within you. He says, get rid of your anger. Get rid of your rage. Get rid of your malicious behavior and your slander and your dirty language. He says, put on your new nature. Be renewed. Learn from your Creator and become like Him. You see, way too many people can't get past their past because they never let go of it. They don't get past it, not because God hasn't given the ability to, but because we don't release it. They ask for forgiveness, but they never ask to be set free. Because holding on to anger at some point makes you feel justified. It's easier to get drunk than it is to get right with people. Or although you know you're in a sexual relationship that you shouldn't be in, at least you feel loved. At least you feel something versus feeling lonely. You see, when Christ sets you free from it, we don't return to it. That in Proverbs 26:11, there's this poignant scripture. And it's Solomon who wrote it. And he said, this is a dog returns to its vomit, so does a fool return to their folly. See, and then there's this other side to it that says that when we have a past, here's what we do. You see, as a dog returns to its vomit, so does a fool return to its folly, goes like this. I used to struggle in an area of my life. I gave that area up to God. He forgave me of it. And now I'm clean of that area. And now I go back and hang around that area. Because why? Because now I'm spiritually strong and spiritually mature. No. In actuality, if you're returning back to areas that you used to struggle with, that's not a sign of spiritual maturity, that's a sign of immaturity. Because if you hang around an area that you used to struggle with, eventually that area has the ability to hook you back in. And you've got to be really, really careful with that. The third thing that I want you to write down is simply this. Is that to get past your past, you must be able to forgive people of their past. Isn't that interesting? I think that is an interesting scripture in principle. For me to get past my stuff, I've got to forgive you of your stuff. Why can't it work out that for me to get past my stuff, I just have to forgive myself? But that's not the way God set it up. That when you struggle with somebody and they've wronged you, in order for you to get past that wrong, it's not that you just have to get past your stuff, you have to get past not forgiving them. And see, that's the hard part. Because unforgiveness makes us feel like we are doing something about something we never did anything about. Does that make sense? Did I lose you in that one? That unforgiveness, when we have unforgiveness in our heart, at least we have something. That when somebody treated us bad or somebody wronged us, whether it's physical abuse or sexual abuse or mental abuse or whatever type of abuse took place, that when we hang on to unforgiveness, the reason we do that is because at that point in that time, we were powerless to do anything about it. And at least by holding on to the unforgiveness, we have some sort of power and control over it. But the truth is this, is you don't control it. It controls you. Because if you controlled it, you would let it go. But since you don't let it go, you don't control it, it controls you. And that's where the sin takes place. Is that instead of letting God take control of your life, you've let something foreign take hold of your heart, and now your heart grows cold towards God. You see, Paul is reminding us in verse 13 that we will never, ever forgive anyone more than God forgave us. He says, make allowance for each other's faults. And you go, okay, I could do that, Paul. I mean, I have the ability to make allowance for each other's faults. I mean, I totally understand that people blow it. And then he says this, make allowance for each other's faults. And then there's a comma there. And then he says, and forgive anyone who offends you. Well, wait, I can forgive some people, right? It's easy to forgive some people, but can you forgive anyone? See, that's the reason why you and I need a relationship with Christ. Because you and I do not have the ability to forgive everyone because of our hearts. And he says, forgive anyone who offends you. Sorry. You see, we're supposed to forgive people for one reason, because we've been forgiven. I like Romans 3:22 that says, we are made right in God's sight when we trust in Jesus Christ to take away our sins. And we can all be saved in the same way, no matter who we are or what we've done. And I believe this with all my heart, that you'll never be able to get past something that you can't forgive. I should probably take a drink right now. And you guys can breathe like, oh, leave me alone tonight. Let's all cough together. That'll make me feel better. If we all cough at the same time, it'll just be a heyday of coughing. But here's what I think is great. Get this. You see, God doesn't struggle to forgive you but he also doesn't struggle to forgive the person who hurt you. Did you get that? See, we want God to struggle. We want God to forgive us for whatever we've done. But in the area that we can't forgive, we feel justified because we've been wronged. And so we choose not to forgive. And so there's no working power in your life, because God can't work in a heart that doesn't want him working in their life. God can't do it. If you don't want God working in your life, he can't. Because he's given you that freedom. But not only does he not struggle with forgiving you, he also does not struggle with the fact that he has the ability to forgive those who hurt you. Make allowance for each other's faults. Because we all have lots of faults, right? And there's two ways you do it, guys. You got to clothe yourself in love. If you want to get past your past, you got to clothe yourself in love. That's the key. Above all else, clothe yourself in love. Verse 14. 1 Peter 4:8. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. You see, the issue isn't the ability to work yourself into a frenzy to where you can get past this, where it's like, okay, I'm going to be nice to him. Have you ever tried that one? You're getting ready to open the door. The person on the other side of the door is the person you despise, can't stand, don't like, has hurt you, offended you, broken your heart. And you're opening the door, and it's going to be like, okay, I'm going to love them. I'm going to be nice. And as soon as you open the door, you're like, oh, you are a jerk. I hate your stinking guts. I hope you die and eat worms. And you feel justified about it. You walk around all night long. Oh, yeah, that guy's a scumbag. The reason you don't have that ability is why? Because this is where the Holy Spirit comes into your life and you say, you know what, God? I know that your love covers a multitude of sins, and I know that your love covers my sins. And so here's what you do, and this is Paul Watson's little secret. This is the thing that keeps him in a place where it becomes easier to forgive. Just before you walk through the door, just before you see the person at Thanksgiving next week, and we are having service, we are on for next week's service, that just before you get ready to open that door and you know that the person's on the other side, here's what you do. You just turn around, you open the door to your life, and you think of all of the times and all of the places that you've screwed up and all the people that you've hurt and all the places you've fallen short, and just go, oh God, I am as broken as anybody on the planet. And Lord, that you would show me how to love the person on the other side of that door, just as you have loved me, the person on this side of the door. And thank you for your forgiveness. You see, the way that you love others is not by working it, but it's by embracing the love that God's given you. Above all else, clothe yourself in love. Love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sin. God has the ability to do in your heart what you don't. God has the ability to create a love in your heart that is patient and kind and doesn't envy and doesn't boast. It's not proud. It's not rude. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. Love has the ability to take reign in your heart that doesn't keep records of wrongs. It does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. And my favorite portion of 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8, is verse 8. Because it says true love. Absolute true love. The kind of love that you're looking for, right? Everybody's looking for true love. The kind of love that you're looking for, but the kind of love that Jesus expects you to have also is true love. The love that never fails. That in everything, that it doesn't fail. Because it's not you who gives it, it's God who gives it through you. And so I want you to write down point five. And just after you write down point five, I want you to, if you're a part of tonight's closing session, tonight's closing service, if you'd go ahead and make your way to the prayer room. And point five is this. You see, if you want to get past your past, then you've got to apply the message of Christ to your life. You see, here's what we do. We think that the message of Christ is just a good message. We know it's God's power, but we don't apply it to our life. And God's message goes unapplied, has no power in change. It only has power when you apply it to your life. Colossians 3:16 says this. And as these guys all move towards the prayer room, just bear with me for 1 second. You see, it's the applied message of the gospel that has the ability to change a person's life. He says in verse 16, he says, let the message about Christ in all its richness fill your lives. Teach and counsel each other with all wisdom he gives. Sing songs and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful heart. In whatever you do or say, will you always remind yourself to do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him, to him, God the Father? You see, here's what he's saying. He's saying, you know what? You can call yourself a Christian all day long to the Colossian church. You can stand as a pillar in your community and say, we are Christians. And if you do not apply the message of the gospel to your life, it has no power. And it doesn't have any power because it doesn't have any power. It doesn't have any power because you're not using the power that God gives you to overcome your stuff. And that's the Holy Spirit. You see, way too many Christians have acknowledged God, but they don't cling to him as God. Proverbs 14:12, and also in Proverbs 16, it says, there's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death. There's a way that seems right to a man. There's a way that seems right, that you offend me, and I'm going to hold on to it. You hurt me, and I'm not going to let go of it. There's a way that seems right to a man. And if that's where you're at, how's that working for you? Are you any happier? Does your life feel any more fulfilled? Do you feel better about unforgiveness in your heart than you do about truly forgiving? The anger that you're hanging on to against your parents, does it make your life better? Because there's a way that seems right to a man, and that seems logical. That seems like somebody hurts me, man, I have the right. But in the end, that leads to death. You know what brings life? Love and forgiveness. And that's what it said in Colossians, that love and forgiveness doesn't just bring life. You know what it brings? It brings peace. That there's peace that comes into your soul. Unforgiveness leaves you unsettled. See, I believe that one of the greatest testimonies of the church is what happens to Christians when they give their life to Christ. You see, the greatest testimony of a church is this, is that you watch people who struggled in life, and all of us do, right? And you give your life to Christ, and then you go back and hang around. Maybe you go back to your 10-year reunion, and maybe you used to be a big drug addict in high school, and everybody remembers you as the drug guy. And they go back, and now you're clean and sober, and they say, man, what happened to you? And you say, oh, I gave my life to Christ. And because I gave my life to Christ, I'm not the same. Maybe you used to struggle with pornography, just off the chart struggle. And you run into buddies that you used to go to strip joints with or whatever. And they say, hey, what happened to you? You say, man, dude, I go to church and I gave my life to Jesus. And they're like, wow, no way, really? What else happened? No, dude, that's it. The testimony of Christ is that you don't stay where you're at because he has the power to change where you're at. It's the Holy Spirit that gives us the ability to overcome. And so here's what we're going to do. We're going to close our service kind of in a neat way. Last week I asked a bunch of you to fill out cards if you wanted to share what God's done in your life. We had about 25 people do that. And I'm going to let them share their testimony with you with nothing but words. Check this out.
And crushed, showed that God is love, and God is just. At the cross you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love.
The testimony of Jesus is that he is alive and he is real, and that there is nothing that you've done in your past that he can't heal, and that no matter how broken you are, that he has the ability to get you past your past if you will let go of it and hang on to and grab on to him, because he is what makes us whole. Because we are in a lost and broken world, but he is not lost nor broken. Let's pray. Father God, we're just going to come before you right now, Lord. But I challenge you, if you are here tonight and you're stuck, that you just put out your hands. Put out your hands and just say, you know what, God, I'm going to receive you tonight. That no matter what anybody thinks or whatever, what's going on around me, that God, that I want to deal with you. And so, Holy Spirit, I just ask that you would fall. That you would pour out upon us as a people, God, who are in desperate need and are searching for you, God. That, Lord, that every day is a struggle. Some days are more of a struggle than other days. And some days the enemy brings up our past way more than other days. But God, that we would clothe ourselves in love and forgiveness, and that you would cleanse us from the people that we are, so that one day that we would stand with signs for the rest of the world to say, it is nothing but Jesus who brings healing. So God, I ask that you would pour yourself out tonight upon us, and that tonight would be a night where we let go of the things that we've held on to that's kept us from holding on to you. We love you, and we praise your name. And the whole church said, amen. Bless you guys. We are really glad that you come on Wednesday nights and you make the door a part of your service. And I believe that when we watch and we watch what God is doing in our life, that you can begin to measure that. And that there's a time where you say, you know what? I used to be here, but now I'm here. And that's the testimony of Christ. If you need prayer, would like somebody to talk to, we'll be around. We've got a worship team. We got our ministry team here, and there's a lot of people who aren't on the ministry team that really do a great job at prayer and counseling. God bless you. Have a great night. Thank you.
Let us worship God, lift and hold.